for Tuesday, March 14th, actually Wednesday, March 15th, 2017. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everybody, for being able to adjust your schedules due to the snowstorm. Item number one, adjustments to the agenda. Are there any adjustments? Seeing none. Moving on to item number two, approval of school board minutes. May I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the school board minutes under agenda 2, A, B, C, and D.
A second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item number three, comments by student representatives. We have Maggie Gleason and Kenan McGrath.
Okay, so the third quarter is quickly coming to a close. So there's definitely a little bit of added stress in the environment at school, but I feel like maybe the snow day, but something else, has like livened up the community a little bit. I don't know, maybe that's just me, but like I feel like everyone's loving school. Other than that, things have been going really well. The AP government trip is leaving next week, so a lot of people are really excited about that. And yeah, anything else to add?
Yeah. So we've had a lot of championships recently, especially from the science bowl team, which everyone was really excited about. And then we're the climate group at school. We're organizing a Bridges dinner, which is people around the community are going to be invited and bring, it's sort of like a potluck style dinner, and I think that's going to have a lot of help in the climate of our school. And I think school has been going really well, especially like the student, I just had the student council meeting this morning, hearing from the junior class about prom being organized, which is really exciting. So everybody's excited, especially since spring is coming and prom and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Thank you, sounds fun. Item number four, comments from the public on agenda items. Is there anybody that would like to comment at this time? Seeing none, we're moving on to item five, communications. First off, we have the Science Bowl state champions. Is there a representative group here?
So I'm just going to introduce these guys. Dr. Gretz, who's the Science Bowl teacher, coach, was not able to be here tonight. But we have five team members who are going to Washington, D.C., all expenses paid. Some point in May, the board will get a travel form, and hopefully you'll authorize it. But anyway, it is all expenses paid, courtesy of the Department of Energy. So these guys are the main state champions. So this is Ryan Collins and Allie Moulton and Sam Berman and Wes Parker and Preston Stewart. And Ryan and Allie are just going to share a few words about what the Science Bowl is all about and how that worked. So thank you for making this time available.
Hi, thank you. So the Science Bowl is a Jeopardy-style science competition with subjects from with math, science, and in science like physics, chemistry, biology, energy, stuff like that. And so there's teams of five, four participate at a time individually, and also working together as a team compiling knowledge. We practiced for
about a month
during our achievement period in school, which is 30 minutes each day. So just going over questions and topics and having competitions that were alike to the ones we'd face in the state championship, so we were quite prepared. And
yeah, so now that we've become the main state champions, we're going to be versing all of the other states in America, or at least the ones that participate in the Science Bowl. We'll be versing them at the national tournament, so we'll be doing basically the same thing, but it's going to be harder, more fast-paced. There's going to be round-robin matches and, like, double elimination rounds, so it'll be a lot tougher, but we're going to prepare for it in a lot the same way, but instead of versing our classmates, we're going to be versing different science teachers and math teachers during practice rounds, so it should be interesting to see how that goes. Thank you.
Interesting to see who wins.
Yeah, and we're very excited to represent the town and the school in Washington, D.C.
Thank you.
Nice. I have some questions.
I just have a quick question. This is a really silly question. But can you, it's not even a question, it's a request. Can you give an example of what a question might be at a round robin tournament? Like, I have no sense of what this is or what it sounds like.
So a lot of the questions actually have to do with things that the Department of Energy and some of their projects have been about, which are hard because we didn't think about studying those beforehand. But so they can be from any subject of science. An example of one, I guess, would be where they would give you a physics equation. Like, they would say, like, a light bulb has, like, 500 coulombs of energy, like, some math thing. a different one would be where they give you a chemical equation, and you have to, like, balance it, or where it gives you a certain amount of moles of, like, in a concentrated liquid, and you have to find, like, how much you need to dilute it. And it's hard because they're timed, so you have, for regular questions, you have 5 seconds to buzz in and answer, so it's kind of like Jeopardy. And then if your team gets that right, then you get a bonus question, and you get 20 seconds to answer that, collaborating with your teammates, and those can be a little bit longer and a little bit more difficult to answer.
It's amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Barbara, I just wanted to add that I appreciate your practice for a month, state champions, but what that says to all of us is your incredibly deep science knowledge over your years here, and bringing that to the table and then just practicing the buzzer Jeopardy thing is what made you state champs. So good for you guys, and good for our teachers and Kate for having you be able to accomplish this.
Thank you. And I'm glad you pointed out the teacher's role, because it's very important, and we're very thankful to our teachers for helping us through. So we're excited to represent Cape. Thank you.
Congratulations.
It's a night of recognition. Next up, we have a legislative sentiment for our mock trial team, and I believe Representative Monahan is here. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I just want to also congratulate the science team, the Science Bowl winners, too. I second Rebecca Millett, Senator Millett, and Representative Hammond. We were all marveling at the article, the Press Herald article, and all I could think of was, after I read it, was, wow, I can't imagine doing that. But congratulations. And on to more congratulations is the Cape Elizabeth High School mock trial team, their 7th win, championship victory in a row, and the team will be representing the Maine at the High School Mock Trial Championship. Where is that going to be taking place? In Connecticut. So I believe that there are 25 very talented students, so I won't be listing all of them, but we're all very proud of all of them, as well as the lead attorneys that helped coach them. It was Dick O'Meara and John Zubrek and David Hillman, and the teacher advisor, Coach Mary Page. All of us in the legislature would like to congratulate the mock trial team and best wishes on this achievement, and that this official expression of sentiment be sent forthwith on behalf of the 128th legislature and the people of Maine. Now this can go up with all the other ones, and that'll just look fabulous. So thank you and congratulations.
Thank you so much. Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
just a few brief comments, and the students, a few students would like to speak. We're very excited to having won 7 years in a row. It is nice to have the sentiment because in the state of Maine, we don't get a trophy or any sort of award, so it's nice to have something that signifies the win. Unlike the Science Bowl, nothing is all expenses paid. We are fundraising right now, so we might be coming around to get your clink bottles or other items. And I'm just going to let the students speak briefly about what they've done in the past and what they hope to accomplish. All these young women will be at the national competition in Hartford.
Hi, my name's Lauren Cutter. I was the only freshman attorney this year for the prosecution team. Being a new student in Cape Elizabeth, it was very nice to have that sense of community through the mock trial team. It made that transition through high school much easier.
Hi, you guys all know me, but I'm Kinnan. I was a captain of the defense team, and this is my first year doing mock trial, and it was the most incredibly run organization, one of the most at the school. I just wanted to commend Ms. Page and all the attorney coaches because they do an incredible job. I went in knowing nothing, and I left having like every objection memorized. But I'm really excited for nationals. I'm really excited to represent the school, and mock trial has actually made me decide to go into college majoring in pre-law, which is interesting because I never planned it like that. But yeah, I was really excited to win, and I think we're all really excited for nationals.
Hi, my name is Mariana Godfrey. I'm a second year sophomore with the mock trial program. I'm an attorney. This is my second year going to nationals. I went to nationals last year in Boise, Idaho. It's a 45-day period, which we spend, 2 to 3 hours per night studying the case, writing our directs, crosses, and preparing our witnesses. It's in a competition. This year it's in Hartford, which we compete against students from all over the country and some out from outside the country. And I was lucky enough to meet a member from every single team last year, and I have stayed in touch with all of them. And mock trial has really taught me how to speak well in public, and I have respected judges and lawyers more now because I am able to watch trials on TV and understand what is really going on. So thank you.
I'm Libby Palanza. I'm a sophomore, and this is my second year doing mock trial. I've had the chance to be both a witness and an attorney in different cases. It's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun, and it's a really great experience. It really helps you learn to think on your feet well and gives you a lot of public speaking experience. And yeah, it's a lot of work, but it's definitely a lot of fun.
Thank you, and we look forward to the national competition. Thank you.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Next up, we have an annual update from our library and instructional technology specialists. I just saw Amanda sneak. Okay.
Perfect timing.
So we have excited to hear from you guys for a few minutes.
Thank you.
I just want to put something up on the screen for all of you, if we could. Not the one we want to project it. This has the notes, does it matter? Okay.
Is there a separate power for the projector? Oh, it's over here. I think I would want this after the sound of it. Does anyone recall how to turn on the projector?
Oh boy. So the two tech people, oh, no. Right? No, this was it.
Does anyone?
Well, it's okay if we don't.
No? Check. I feel like it's right over here. Make sure it's coming up.
Thank you, Mr. Duffy.
Hey, how are you? I think I got it on. I just hit that, so. Hopefully. It's promising. That looks close.
We're getting there. It's warming up.
Oh, except it's the mirror displays.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Good evening. Sorry. Amanda and I recognize that we have a tendency to be somewhat verbose, so at Howard's request, we are going to be very brief. Our intent this evening is to give you a brief verbal overview of some additional materials that we've provided in a slideshow, which you'll be able to see in just a moment. And we'll start with just a summary slide that asks you to kind of look at the big picture, and then we thought we'd project a day in the life of a library instructional technology specialist, and that'll give you some additional information. And then we're happy to email this to you, or if you want to go online to take a look at it, there are about 10 pages of slides that detail what else we've been talking about, but unlike previous years, we're not going to take you through those. So our biggest probably offer is that we'd love to have you come visit us and see what we're talking about in person. I know Carolyn and Ginger would love that as well, as would Cam and Tom. If you haven't had a chance to see how the three spaces have evolved over the last couple of years, Pond Cove and the high school have dramatically changed since last you saw them, and we are even more flexible and attractive than we were at first. But really want to extend that invitation very much to anyone who'd like to come, and then certainly to ask questions this evening to interrupt us as we're both off in freight trains going forward. Stop question. Or, of course, to email us if you'd like as well. And those blue words up there are links to our email.
My name is Amanda Kozaka. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to return for a third year in a row to share news about the middle school library and learning commons. This year, we proudly recognize the achievement of a lot of our long-term goals, ones that we may have spoken of in our first visit here. We envisioned a thriving, innovative, student-centered library space, and in many ways we have achieved that. Of course, our work is not done, but in many ways we have achieved that. We envisioned implementing a 21st century program, like rich, thriving program for our students, our digital age students, and in many ways we've accomplished that. So this year we mark a shift to a much more focused, standards-driven approach to curriculum development and instruction as it relates to our library program at the middle school.
So the five examples up there are detailed in the slides that follow. And as I said, I'm happy to email those to you after the presentation. But each of them is an illustration, an example, in no way a comprehensive description, but just something that we hope gives you an idea, as will the next slide, which is the day in the life. And also to point out that one of the real victories for us, or sort of we're thrilled, that both the high school and Pond Cove spaces were based on the research we did and the implementation of the Learning Commons. So Carolyn and I at the high school very closely modeled the space and the redevelopment of that on what Amanda and I did at the middle school, and really have felt like that's a transformative experience for them as well. A lot more flexible furniture, if you haven't seen that, bookcases that move around, concepts like not having the bowling alley theory of the faculty meeting where people are 70 feet from Jeff. It really has made a big difference, and also in the sense that we've experienced multiple instructional spaces simultaneously, as well as a beautiful pair of study rooms, one of which is a green screen studio and the other which is for group study. So those have been terrific additions as well, and we felt like those work beautifully at the middle school. So in the example of fifth and sixth grade Idea Lab, we've talked about that with you in the past. This is innovate, discover, explore, amaze. We talk a lot about the ways that we hope students will take risks. And in this particular case, we've done a lot with digital citizenship, information literacy, and then technology, direct instruction, taking some of the weight off of classroom teachers so that the students enter their classrooms with particular skills that teachers can then take out of their teaching time and assume that they've learned with us. In the realm of Maine's guiding principles, we've been able to sort of lead the way in some of that implementation, particularly in areas that are reflected in the portfolios that we're getting students to develop. Recognizing that the class of 2021 will need those portfolios, we've set up a protocol for getting every student in the building to have in place a digital portfolio, and really emphasize to them and to their teachers that the self-directed learning piece of that, the community involvement, are very difficult to demonstrate through grades and test scores. So we've looked at alternative sort of outside-the-box thinking, like record your piano recitals over the course of 5 years and put those in to show how you've changed as a self-directed learner. Highlight reels from sporting events. That's really been a shift in people's perception that that's what belongs in there. And then very verbally, very vocally, embraced failure as a way to learn, and saying that you want those portfolios to include not just your final products, but all the steps along the way, integration of teacher feedback, that focus being the way to capture growth over time and not the final product that we've looked at frequently in the past as sort of the achievement.
Right. We love self-directed learners because it actually, in the guiding principles, because it actually uses the term growth mindset. We love it. I need a shirt that just says growth mindset. So I'm going to talk just very briefly about additional standards-driven programming, some professional development and leadership that we've been a part of, and lastly to touch upon what our next steps are, what are our continuing goals. You know, we said we've accomplished a lot, but in no way are we done, and we never see our work as completed. We see ourselves as continually evolving. So in addition to coursework and instruction guided, driven by the guiding principles, which is our framework for designing designing some of our curriculum, we are also very much driven by standards such as the ISTE student standards that were released in 2016, most particularly on digital citizenship, being a knowledge constructor, and a creative communicator. These standards drive our work developing, for example, our tech advisory program. At the middle school, we have this year started a 7th and 8th grade tech advisory program, and it is also evolving into our tech team at the middle school. And those are our three, in addition to the guiding principles, those are our three to create curriculum and programming for those students. For example, for our own leadership and professional development, we do, of course, recognize what we're doing, the opportunities that we have here in the district. We have great opportunities in the middle school, always evolving, to work with our grade level teachers and our team leaders. We are beginning to and continuing to, extend our reach to our neighboring buildings to strengthen our ties with Pond Cove and to strengthen our ties with the high school program. But in addition to what we're doing here in the district, we want to point out what we've been doing beyond the district, because it is very much what we have been able to do professionally beyond the district is very much because of what we've been able to do in our district. So our accomplishments here in our district have propelled us professionally, and because of what we're doing professionally, we bring back a lot more to our district, and we have this great cycle of professional development going. This guy can be a bit humble, believe it or not. He is the ISTE Librarians Network president currently. He is very much involved in the ACTM planning. He is involved in just about every ed camp that's in the state of Maine. Recently, he had a quick trip down to Washington, D.C. to attend a Future Ready summit at the White House. So very, very much involved in ISTE, ACTM, Maine libraries, and National Library programs, and all of that work, leaving the district, traveling, networking, has he brings it all back to our program here. So I wanted to gloat about him a little bit. I am a little bit closer to home, but I am currently finishing up my first year of 2 years as the president-elect of the Maine Association of School Libraries. Next year, I will take on the role of president for a couple years, which means I am very much involved in the American Association of School Libraries. I'm a part of their affiliate. I'm a representative, a delegate to their affiliate assembly, which means if you see my purchase orders of, like, going back and forth to conferences in Atlanta and Florida and things like that, that Maslow's paying for, don't worry. So getting involved with librarian organizations, not just here in the district, but in Maine and beyond. And I'm fortunate to say I've had some opportunities because of that to be more involved in state planning, state level planning for libraries. For example, there's a just newly formed statewide advisory board that for school libraries, and I was invited on behalf of Mazel and on behalf of my work as a library instructional technology specialist to be involved in that board. So it's both a brag and a gratitude that we're able to do all of this. And again, we're trying to keep it brief. We can go on and on and on, but we're trying to keep it brief. We want you to know that we are, whether or not you hear you know, news updates or you're hearing about big splashy things happening in the library, we want you to know that we are always really actively moving forward and staying involved and doing what's always doing what's right for our students and our staff at the middle school.
So did you talk about the other one? Should I go there?
Sure.
So that's what we thought would give you a typical day for us, and hopefully generate some questions. I did want to thank both Mike and Doug for being incredibly supportive of our program and really helping us figure out ways to get into the student schedule and into department meetings and time with faculty to help them develop their programming that connects to our work, and also to Kathy Stankard, who's been incredibly helpful as we move towards this standards alignment, and especially connecting our K-12 programming. As a minor example of that, Tom Chartre at Pine Cove is working very hard to get the fourth grade students coming in with skills that we can capitalize on in fifth grade. And in the last 2 years, we have both seen incredible strides in what those students are able to do, as simple as log into Google Drive without the 50-minute conversation about the way in which passwords work to get us into our Google Drive, but as complex as students who are ready for our tech team coming into fifth grade, okay, what can I do to help teachers? You know, I'm comfortable with going to them and helping with decisions that they're making about the appropriate technology, and Amanda and I are like, and go forth and prosper, that sounds fantastic. So really seeing that connection, and then having worked at the high school, our eighth grade, ninth grade connection, and making sure that the skills we're working on in information literacy, in particular in digital citizenship, are ones that prepare rising ninth graders for the expectations that are there. And even as early as sixth grade, Joe Doan's class was doing some research, and I said, let's talk for a minute about citation and why it's really important and why you will love me in a few years for this right. little lecture. And then we talked for a few minutes, and the hilarity of this kid was like, so you're saying if I don't cite, I can't use it? Yes, that is exactly what I'm saying. Talking to them about plagiarism. So really feeling like that connection is much more intentional, and Kathy's been great about giving us some opportunities to have those conversations, working on developing our website over the next couple months to really reflect the three different but also common threads of our work. And then one other example I point out up here is opportunities that we have to go back and forth between digital and print resources. I think a lot of people think we've burned all the books and thrown them out, and we only did that with a few. We felt as though the opportunities to develop, for example, a digital resource list where teachers could access, again in Joe's class, African-American biography materials. And then we augment the resources there with digital pieces. We update the collection to reflect more recent developments, and have also had this opportunity to share with students the concept of information that's up to date and reliable, as opposed to just out there in the world.
So I think our, in closing, and I'll be very brief, our next steps are about continuing curriculum development, continuing to develop connections throughout the schools, and what we need to focus on to solve some of those challenges that we have are really meeting time across the district, opportunities for the library department to be seen as a department that needs departmental time, so that what we're doing is even more strengthened by its unity and its clarity. So next year, if you let us come back, hopefully we'll have a lot to say about what we're doing district-wide. And I will say, as a last thought, this was when we originally asked to have this time before you, we intended to have our whole team of us up here. But Carolyn and Ginger are just such go-getters. They presented to you guys a couple weeks ago, right? And I think it sounds like they really did a great job of role modeling how they differentiate instruction and technology integration. So they're rock stars. I'm sure you're going to be hearing from Tom Chaltrey and Cameron Rosenblum soon, as maybe right after they finish their ISTE standards night. What's the event called? And it's coming up soon.
Yeah, they're using Tom and Cam have developed a curriculum for this evening family event like we've done in the past, where they're focusing on natural science of the ocean as a way to illustrate the primary aspects of the ISTE standards and right. The hilarity of these fourth graders looking at me like I thought I was so cool at the national conference, like, hey guys, these are the ISTE standards, aren't they neat? And the fourth grader's like, yeah, I know, but here's the, and he's giving me back something right. far more articulate right. than I could provide. So
right. So hopefully they'll have a chance to come and tell you all about that. Next year, I would like to have all of us here, six of us here. Mm-hmm. Is it six? Yeah, mm-hmm. Six of us here. Sharing even more successes. But thank you all for giving us the opportunities to do all this great stuff. We really could not do this, I think, anywhere else and with any other group of people. So thank you for the opportunity. All right. Questions?
I would just like to say that I think that these are lifelong skills that I so totally did not appreciate when I was in school.
Right.
But now when I look back, almost everything I do in my professional life touches yeah. on yeah. citing things that it's not for plagiarism and making yeah. sure that I can do research, evidence-based, mm-hmm. and present a paper. And you can't do that without those skills that you're really throwing right. down now. So mm-hmm. thank you for that work.
Absolutely. We love Mean Guiding Principles, I'll tell you. Like that's where we always point kids to that and say, you know, this is describing the behaviors you need. This isn't about, like, can you do this math problem or do you know this date? This is, how do you behave? How do you act? What are you, you know, kind of not programmed, but what is your mindset allow? What can that allow you to do? So we've been using more and more of the Main Guiding Principles and really excited about how we're kind of forging ahead with that at the middle school. When our teachers are really working hard on the content area, we're able to explore that.
Amanda joked about her t-shirt, but a fifth grader today actually rolled his eyes at her. It's like, let me guess, we're talking about growth mindset.
Yeah.
It was awesome. Like, indeed, we are.
We've gotten to the point that we wanted to.
We're predictable at this point.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you so much. Have a great
all right.
Next, we're moving on to a superintendent search update. March has been a very busy month for the school board and the superintendent search. We had the advisory screening committee, which read all applications and using a rubric screened applications to make recommendations. That committee consisted of community members, parents, teachers, central office staff, administrators, and a few board members. So we really had broad input and a lot of different perspectives in that group. That group made its recommendation to the next group, which was the interview committee. And the interview committee also had Pond Cove Middle School, high school teacher representation, building principal, central office staff, and specifically our special services director, because we wanted to actually be really careful that we had special education in mind as we made some of these decisions. The full board was a part of that group, as well as a building principal. So that group has met and further narrowed the field, and we move on to have further interviews. It is possible that if all goes well, that we may announce one or two finalists next week. And if we go ahead with our schedule, that we will visit districts where these finalists are currently employed to get a sense of how they, you know, work there and what people think of them. And during that same week, we would have that one or two finalists here in Cape Elizabeth for a visit, very similar to last year, except we're going to provide an evening opportunity so that more community members can meet the finalists. So stay tuned. We're working hard. We'll keep you updated. And moving on to item E, we have efforts to align curriculum and institute proficiency-based education.
Thank you. Well, I believe it was at your last budget workshop that I did point out a question that has been raised by a couple of people generally wondering if it, in this difficult budget time that we have with shrinking state revenues and very tight budgets, if perhaps we could spend this next year without filling the position of Director of Teaching and Learning, thereby saving that salary and either using it differently or perhaps just reducing the budget. I'm not sure what. But just thinking that maybe there could be other ways to go about moving that work forward without hiring a director. Remember, we have Kathy Stenker, that job this year as an interim. She came in for 1 year, and that year ends in June. So during the budget workshop, it was requested by a board member to kind of know a little bit more about how are we, what progress is being made in aligning curriculum and instituting proficiency-based education. And Kathy was kind enough to send you all kind of a short summary of what work is underway and progress is being made K-12. So hopefully that answers your question about where we are. I think it's fair to summarize it as saying that, you know, it's clearly a work in progress. It's complex work. Teachers and building level administrators are appreciative of the need for aligning our curriculum and being more proficient ourselves with proficiency-based education leading toward proficiency-based diplomas for high school students 4 years out. So our teacher, I'm really happy to report to you, people aren't saying, what or why would we want to do that? They're saying, yes, we need to do this, and we have committees formed. It's quite good. And so that's the answer to your question. It's moving forward. All that work's moving forward. And honestly, I don't know about measuring it against other years. I think that we're making at least as much gain this year as we have in some time, with no disrespect to the past years. But I think that I give everybody and our schools and our administration credit for that. So the other question that came up was, we agreed that rather than answering the question the other night, well, gee, what do you think about that idea of maybe putting this position on the back burner for the year, the feeling was, let's just slow it down and think about this and discuss it perhaps at our next meeting that happens to be tonight. So I think you understand basically the depth and the breadth of that job, which is as someone said earlier today in a meeting, it's more than meets the eye, and it's more than just curriculum and teaching and learning. It's a lot of other jobs that benefit the entire school system in the district, and nothing more important though than supporting our teachers and giving them encouragement and direction that they're asking for. So no action needs to be taken unless you want to either, I mean, you've already created the position, you've already got a job description, it's actually been updated, and it's in your budget. So no action needs to be taken, just steady ahead. What you would do if you wanted to reconsider that temporarily or permanently would be that's what you would do to make action. So if someone wants to say, I move that we do X, Y, or Z, then that's what you're here to talk about tonight. Otherwise, it's steady ahead. So I don't know where you want to go with this, but we try to give you the information that you asked for. And I will say to you, from my perspective, and I believe that I actually heard it said better today in a meeting we had in preparing for the search for the director from some teachers and administrators in the room. They were clear today as a group that this position is valuable and necessary for us to keep moving ahead. That's, and I totally agree with that. So if there's any doubt about my feeling or the feeling of some, at least those who I spoke with today in a interview committee, and I don't assume they represent all teachers at all, but we something's going well right now, we need to keep at it. That's kind of what I heard. And two of you as board members were there. I mean, I think that, am I accurate? Am I,
yes,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so there you go.
Susanna Bindra.
Oh, sorry. I just want to say thank you to Kathy for updating the description. And I think just based on what I saw in the updated list, it is definitely more than meets the eye on that level. But I also get the sense that it feels palpable that teachers feel that the progress being made this year is significant and something that they've been waiting for. So among many other reasons why I believe we just move steady ahead, I think it's really important work. And I think it sounds like also the teachers totally feel the same way in terms of the value of this position and then the person behind the position.
John?
So I just wanted to add, sort of this sort of came up originally in our budget context, and some of it sounds, I think, relatively academic when you talk about curriculum alignment and performance-based learning and those sorts of things. And it's, you know, this is actually really important stuff that has a big impact on both the, on the learning of and achievement of the kids. When you talk about curriculum alignment, you know, that's really about being efficient and in the classroom and building on what came before, so you don't constantly feel like you're switching back and forth between inches and centimeters and back and forth, and one thing builds on the next, and so you're ready to learn, and it all works smoothly. And we've got still work to do there, and we're headed in the right direction, and it's really important for the impact on learning. And the same with performance-based learning. It's not only a state requirement, but it's also, that's the way education is moving. That's the way we need to be. And we've got a ways to go, and I'm delighted to have someone who's really leading the way and is going to get us there, because that's where we need to go. And it had, these two things, they sound academic, but they have a big impact on improving the education achievement in our district, and I fully support it.
So,
further discussion?
No, I would just throw in that I have personally experienced leadership in two districts where the position was not there and it was subdivided among other admin team members, and despite tremendous willingness and effort, it did not happen. I am a strong believer that it's a huge job. It's critical to our work right now. The job description is very robust, and I really think for us to stand behind what we say where we're headed, it's a critical spot for us. We just need to fund it.
Mm-hmm. Agree.
Okay.
I think the temperature of the board is steady ahead.
Yep, got it. So my report, try to keep this brief. You know that I was talking with you earlier about a possible grant being submitted by Keep Elizabeth, Scarborough, South Portland, and Portland, and Westbrook, to do a study on ways that we can work together for transportation, training, buses, routes, dispatch, and so forth. We're apparently, the amount of information that needed to be gathered by the deadline set by the Department of Ed couldn't be met, so the grant was not submitted. However, if there's a strong feeling that the money will be available again next year, and all these schools are geared now to have a grant in on time. But meanwhile, I also asked the other superintendents if they'd be willing to just pony up some money so that collectively we could get an initial study done and pay for it among ourselves out of our budgets. And I think that there's general feeling that, gee, let's consider that. I don't know. We haven't had a chance to really sit down and have that discussion, but I know a couple of superintendents I've spoken with seem they think that's a real possibility, which would be fun. I'd like to see us get some initial work done by hiring consultants to try and help us direct our focus where we would get the most benefit in terms of efficiency and cost savings. So we'll keep you appraised of that. This is a night of celebrations of student accomplishments. We've already heard a couple of them. Another would be the middle school chess club. And I think Mike could, if you don't mind, stand up and let you know the names of some students at the middle school who apparently are state champions. There's a long list of individuals, and other students did incredibly well as well, but just sensitive to the time. Well, maybe you would mind just reading off the list of...
Very happy to announce and recognize some Cape Elizabeth chess players who are Maine State Scholastic Chess Champions as of Saturday. They include Maddie Hansen, Zoe Dinnerstein, Trevor Oakley, Ben Gordon, Henry Abramson, and Simon Shika Brown. They won the K-6 State Scholastic Chess Championship. And so several other students did quite well, and there was a novice section as well, but I'll announce the six winners. So.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
This is a real big deal, and this is a club that has been a volunteer coach and students coming in on their own after school and traveling about, coming together, being advised and encouraged, trained at school, and again, pretty much on their own have done this. It's pretty impressive, to say the least. Yes?
I'm just wondering, who is their coach?
Mike misses the gentleman's name.
I'll go with Mike. Sorry.
I believe they meet Saturday mornings.
Right.
Yeah. They were led by a very proud parent, Eric Dinnerstein, who is the father of one of the champions who
That's
was mentioned.
A lot of work. Thank you.
A lot of work on a volunteer basis. So thank you, Dr. Dinnerstein.
So what we're talking about is, given the fact that this program has been in place for a couple of years now on a volunteer basis, that hopefully you would agree that this could be considered going forward a middle school enrichment program, I guess you would call it co-curricular, as opposed to extracurricular, I would think, and it would be a stipend position that Mike would factor into his distribution of funds for coaches. But given that, not just because they won the state championship, though that's impressive, but that they've been working on this for a couple of years, they've been regular attendees, they have shown interest, and the program has shown success, that seems to be that they've gone over the bar. And so why not? So I just want you to be aware that next year Mike will see this as a school-endorsed program. They'll get the benefits of travel and transport, you know, and recognition of being really seen as the school's program as opposed to a club. Great. Okay. So let's see. Now another program. The high school, I guess it's also middle school, but is it largely high school or robotics team, Jeff?
There's teams from both each school.
Right. I'm probably going to need both principals to help me with this one, too. But the school's team has done, I think, again, won the state championship in this, believe it or not. And the school sponsors students to go as far as the states, but once you get out of Maine, we wish you well. And finances are not part of the bargain. So the students are raising the funds, and it's complicated because now we find out that two things. One is the chaperone who normally would go isn't available to go. We do have somebody else who we think is well-trained, has been vetted, has worked with the students, knows the administration and the rules, and would be willing to be considered to be the chaperone in charge with adequate training and support. But it would be a bit unusual because we wouldn't have a school employee going. There isn't one available. So we need to talk to you about that. Without that, the problem begins to be around insurance, about the computers and equipment and the robotics that go with the students. If they aren't, if they're independent of the school, the insurance just doesn't cover them. And getting a rider is not easy at all. So we think it's best for the students to be seen as a school-sponsored event, but that means a chaperone. So if you don't mind, we'd like to come back and talk to you about a proposal of a community member being the chaperone, assigned chaperone, at your meeting on the 28th of this month. We could add that to the agenda and spend like maybe 10 minutes explaining. I mean, Jeff and maybe Mike will put together a written proposal, so you'll have it in advance of that to kind of see what's being proposed and what it means, and you could act on it if you wish on the 28th. Agree?
Sounds great.
Thank you. So, the search committee that has been formed for the Director of Teaching and Learning met today for the first time. We've set interviews for late March. We talked about the qualities that we're looking for in a director. It was a very good meeting. I enjoyed a lot the people that have volunteered to serve with us. We have administrators, we have teachers, we have board members. It's really a very good group, representing people from all of our schools. And so we feel that we're in good shape with that, and we'll move ahead. I'm guessing that probably by your April meeting, we would, everything being equal, would be able to make a recommendation. We're not feeling any rush, but it's possible. let's see. I also want to mention to you two other things. One is that the administration met early Monday morning. It feels like about 2 weeks ago tonight. and we talked about what the heck can we do to keep the budget from growing for next year, but also meet our staffing needs. I mean, it's really our highest priority is staffing. And we want you to know that everybody's really doing their best to be creative, to share, to pitch in. A lot of interesting ideas are bantered about. And we're just going to keep working at it, but we hope that by the time that you meet again about this next week? Mm-hmm. So maybe even by next week, but no later than 28th, to have some real suggestions that might make a difference in terms of trade-offs. So we'll keep you appraised, but just know that we're not just waiting for you to figure it out. We're trying to figure it out ourselves or give you some ideas of things that we think make some sense. The last thing I'll mention, I hate to bring it up, but the young ladies did earlier snow days. So I think we've had five now. I'm not sure, but I guess five. So that means that what we're trying to do is avoid going into that last week of June. So right now, we just moved over to Thursday. And one more snow day gets us, obviously, to Friday. After that, we're into that last week, which isn't going to be popular with anybody. Students, parents, teachers, anybody. So there, I just want to outline for you some of the options that we have. And I did talk to the calendar committee and heard some nice things, but we didn't really agree on anything, but we conversed through email. But one of them is this option of adding an hour to the end of a day for so many days, and so many of those days, I think it's five, equals a school day. One has to really wonder what educational gain is made at the end of the day, adding an hour. I mean, seriously, educationally, as opposed to just clocking the time. But that's an option. Another one is that we take some days out of the April vacation, if we needed one or two. That won't go well with people, including students, parents, and teachers, and administrators who have got plans to be away on April. So you lose all those people, it's going to be interesting. But there's that possibility. But then again, what's the quality of those days if you're missing 30-40% of your student body and faculty? Then there are Saturdays. That's another option. A lot of people have a lot of activities planned with organizations, families, trips, picnics, church, I don't know what, but you know, Saturdays are also not going to be a really exciting option, but again, we can consider Saturdays. Another one is to roll into that last week of June. A lot of families are away by then. There are camps, there are jobs, there are summer jobs for students and teachers. I mean, just that also is not particularly attractive. So So and the last one I'm going to mention is one that you could just think about, is to wonder if you want to, if need be, to direct me to submit a request to the commissioner to ask for a waiver of one or more instructional days. In other words, if we get, we can handle one more, right? One more. But say that there are two more. What you could do if you wanted to is be to ask me to ask the commissioner to waive that one last day. And I could point out in the letter why that makes sense and so forth and see what happens. So anyway, so I just wanted to kind of just have that in front of you to be aware that who knows what's going to happen between that now and end of season.
Do we have a commissioner?
Yeah, passing.
Well, I don't know how to act.
Well, kind of sarcastic.
Last week we had an acting commissioner, Bob Hassan, but I think Bob's still there.
I think so.
Bob's still
there. Bob's still
okay.
There.
Okay, yeah. Just checking. Mm-hmm.
So, okay, that's it.
Thank you. Susanna was going to update us on a new community organization.
Yep, and I have mentioned it a couple of times, I think with a different, slightly different name, the Cape Diversity Group, but now we're officially, or now the group is officially called Cape Diversity Coalition, CDC for short. So the group is made up of community members, some administrators, teachers, and I go too. but we are in the process of composing a resolution that would ideally be brought forth to the school board, and also to town council. Ideally, a united front, but to be worded slightly different for the school board. And we have met with town council in Portland and reviewed other resolutions in other towns that have recently gone public with their affirmations of being welcoming, inviting districts to all sorts, and that being a nutshell of what the Cape Diversity Coalition is hoping to do with their resolution. So I would really like to request that we put it on the agenda, perhaps with a future April board meeting, that certain members of the CDC group come in and present their resolution to the school board.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to new business, item 6A. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the job description for student support coordinator.
I second.
Discussion?
Just tell us a bit about?
I think, could you just give us a quick, we saw this.
No, I'm not going to.
Oh.
But Jessica.
But Jessica.
That's what she's doing. Right.
You knew.
So this position, or these two positions, what we're proposing is a reallocation of current special ed case manager positions, and we're looking to at all of the items that special ed teachers / case managers do throughout the day, and we're trying to make better support systems. One of the big things with these two positions is that we want them to overlap at the middle school and kind of look at kids coming up to the middle school and kids going to the high school. So all of the things that we as a department have noticed that we might not catch the first time, or the extra supports, the extra testing, these two positions would allow that support, but also allow support for regular ed teachers in trying to put the accommodations into place. Really having other eyes besides mine that look at things K-12 and making sure that things continue to move forward.
Mm-hmm. May I just, am I right though that these jobs would be filled ideally by current teachers, and they would be basically reassigned to these new jobs, and then so there is no additional, these are not two jobs that require two new to be funded, they're already in the budget.
Right? That's correct. And in the meeting last week, I showed you the reallocation of case numbers, and it's maybe one or two higher than what is present this year.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6B, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the nomination of new personnel for 2016-2017 of Laura Ruel for occupational therapist for 0.6 full-time employee.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6C, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the superintendent's recommendations for administrator probationary contract renewals for the 2017-2018 school year for Teresa Current as the Pond Cove assistant principal and Jessica Clark as the director of special services.
I second.
And is this the second probationary year for Teresa and first for Jess? Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Happy to have them aboard.
Thank you. And thank you. Item 6D, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the 2016-2017 athletic and co-curricular personnel nominations as outlined in our agenda for this evening.
A second.
Discussion? Although it sounds like a broken record, it is not. I just would like to extend the board's appreciation for each of these people stepping up to work with the students. These programs don't happen without you. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6E, may I have a motion, please?
Yes, I'll move that we approve a replacement of the school board's 2016-17 superintendent search interview committee in the person of Debbie Butterworth representing the elementary school.
I second that.
Thank you. I have never written your initials before, so I'm like, hey. I would like to thank Debbie Butterworth for stepping in. We had some difficulty with timing and people had to move off the committee, so I just wanted to thank her. A very, very valuable voice. Mm-hmm. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 7, committee reports. Policy?
Policy met this evening at 5:30. To continue our conversation about our current volunteer policy, IJOC, John Holdridge was able to continue a really in-depth discussion about our current volunteer protocols, some improvements he's suggesting, questions that have come to him. And after a thorough talking about this now over two policy committee meetings, he's prepared to look at our policy, rewrite sections of it a bit, at some places where we're really going to invite teachers into helping us partner with the oversight of volunteers a little more aggressively at the start of the year. And we should, we'll review those at our next meeting briefly and bring that language to the April board meeting. And we'll also then be inviting Kathy to join us to talk about a series that that speak to proficiency-based graduation diplomas around our graduation requirements, progress through the grades, et cetera, approval of curriculum. And we still have on our plate for this spring a wellness proposal that will be coming to us for policy, as well as medical marijuana. So we still have those things to address before the end of our school year.
Thank you for that work.
I just want to update for the Finance Committee. If you all haven't heard, it's budget season. Last week, we had a 3.5-hour long meeting. The department heads all put forth their proposals for the school board and the public to hear. It was taped. You can view those tapes online. If you have any questions about any nitty-gritties on the handouts that we were looking at and the binders, those are all available online. They are on our homepage. There's a link on the top that says the 2017-2018 school budget. And I just want to underscore one more time that although we have been taking some hits in state funding, we are still able to pull out one of the second lowest per pupil costs within our competitive districts. So take heart, we're doing great, and it's we will work some magic. And we can't wait to hear. Yesterday was our deadline for folks submitting questions for the administrators to gather answers to so that they can come back with some thoughtful response, and we'll hear those next Tuesday.
And I did want to just update on the town comprehensive plan planning committee. I believe it is, I'm searching frantically for the confirmed date, but I believe it is Monday, April 3rd, that we are going to have an additional meeting to interview two, possibly three consultants to run surveys and do opinion polls of the town and schools to help develop the comprehensive plan going forward. And then the regular monthly meeting is Wednesday, April 12th at 7 o'clock. And I believe the Monday, if I have the date right, April 3rd is 5 to 7. And both meetings encourage public participation. And I would say that it would be very, very helpful for anybody who is interested in having their opinions considered for the survey to come to the Monday interview group. So you can let the people who are we'll be considering using to run the opinion polls, you can let them know and the committee know what you would like to see the town provide in the next 10 years.
So the wellness committee has been meeting, as Barbara mentioned. We're working hard on a policy, and we've been meeting every week. Our next meeting is next Wednesday. We meet at 7:30 in the health room at Pond Cove, and it's just a bunch of really dedicated people willing to do the work and look at it with a really fresh eye of what wellness means in the greater sense. So it's been really great. And the other committee I'd like to report on is Buildings and Grounds. We met today talking about the CIP plan and what does that mean and what is the process of how we get to what's being recommended and how items make it onto that CIP plan and how items get moved off. And we didn't get to finish our discussion, so we have a meeting scheduled next Wednesday at 1:30 again. So that's moving along, trying to create more clarity and give this Buildings and Grounds Committee a little bit more of a substantial energy and base and life to it again that it feels like it hasn't had in a little while. And there's been some good discussions happening about what needs to be done and how do we go about doing that and what is the CP plan and what is the, help me out, Howard, operational budget? Is that the other thing we were talking about? And hearing from various members of the committee that have various different roles within the district and telling us their opinions and their frustrations and their concerns and their hopes and you know, trying to be creative and finding ways to really get the district to some of the things that need to happen. So it's just an ongoing conversation that's gaining momentum and strength and excitement, I think.
Mm-hmm. You too.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Can I just mention one more thing back to Joanna's report about budget review? A week ago, you and Kathy really came up with a great agenda that brought us through the entire budget, and I just thought it'd be nice to acknowledge all the people who came to listen, including some of our town councilors, that was a big a give up of an evening for them to sit with us for 3.5 hours, and I thought it was great, and how you designed that agenda I thought really worked well, and they certainly came away having a much better feel for all of our challenges and hopes and dreams and realities. So,
well, Barbara, I have to hand that one back to you. I think the evening wouldn't have happened had you not come forward with some really great ideas of how to reformulate the way in which we roll out that budget to the process. Is just we've stepped back, we reevaluated, and realized that the dripping out of every week for a month over this and that was hard to sort of get your head around the entire budget. So putting it all together in one evening was a useful, painful experience, I think. It, you know, 3.5 hours actually went by.
It was. It seemed
yeah,
to.
It yeah. did.
Yeah. So thank
so
you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Further reports? Moving on to item 8, school board agenda requests. I believe Susanna made one.
Yes,
regarding
request the presentation of a resolution by the group, mm-hmm. the CDC.
Got it. Thank you. Any others? And for the public, agenda requests can be made by contacting the superintendent and or myself via smoke signal, email, phone call, that sort of thing.
Running into Hannaford's.
Yeah, Hannaford, not at the bananas. Item 9, announcements of upcoming meetings. I believe Barbara did policy already.
I mentioned Tuesday, April 4th, 6:30, place to be announced.
Mm-hmm.
Comp plan, the regular monthly meeting will be Tuesday or Wednesday, April 12th. And then the other one that I'm not 100% sure on, which I know it's on a Monday, and coming up in the next 2 weeks, I'm sure it's on the town website.
Mm-hmm. And finance, so the budget meeting series does continue. This time our next budget agenda will be answering some of the questions that people have posed and also hearing any budget updates from Howard and the gang. We're looking forward to hearing that on Tuesday, March 21st. It will be videotaped, and it will be held in the Cape Elizabeth High School Library and Learning Commons at 6:30. I want to call it columns for some reason. I don't know why. At 6:30. And then that will be followed up with Tuesday, April 11th, when we meet back here during our regular board meeting, where we actually then are... Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped a day. I skipped the 28th. I just want to, you know, get all this through. On Tuesday, March 28th, will be a follow-up from that, answering any other outstanding questions, and the school board will take a straw poll on where we're feeling with the budget. We'll come back to you on April 11th with an adopted budget proposal in our regular business meeting, and then we turn it over to the town council on Tuesday, April 25th, with a mutual workshop. And then the Town Council Finance Committee will take it up on their budget public hearing on the regular Town Council on Monday, May 8th. They vote on Monday, May 15th. And please mark your calendars for Tuesday, June 13th, when the school board budget goes to referendum. Did you get all that?
I think we did.
Thanks.
And I believe Heather talked about next wellness, and you talked about the next buildings and grounds.
Both next Wednesday, 7:30 for wellness and 1:30 for buildings and grounds.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Item 10, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we adjourn.
Second.
I'm going to write that KC again. All those in favor? Thank you. Have a good evening.
So